Welcome to Her Remarkable History. Remember to support, subscribe. History's most savage and prolific serial killer, Elizabeth Báthory. Throughout history, there is a lot of debate over who the most prolific murderers were. You may be thinking of Jack the Ripper or Ted Bundy, or maybe even John Wayne Gacy. But you are only thinking of male murderers because those are the names you know. If we look into the prolific female killers, then there is one name that towers above them all, Elizabeth Báthory. Elizabeth has even been dobbed by the Guinness World Records as the most prolific, but her actual number of victims is debated. Now, who was Elizabeth? Well, she was born on a family estate in Royal Hungary in 1560, and she spent her childhood at Eschid Castle. Elizabeth's parents were wealthy, and as the daughter of Baron George VI Báthory and Baroness Anna Báthory, she was the niece of Stephen Báthory, the King of Poland, Grand Duke of Lithuania, and Prince of Transylvania. It is believed that Elizabeth had some form of epilepsy, as she suffered from many seizures as a child. It is also believed that she developed epilepsy because of the interbreeding of her parents. It is important to remember this when we delve further into her story, but because Elizabeth had epilepsy, and at the time it was known as the falling sickness, the treatments included the rubbing of a non-sufferer's blood on the lips of the patient, or by giving the patient who suffered from the epilepsy a mix of non-sufferer's blood and a piece of skull as the seizure ended. Maybe this is where Elizabeth developed her need for killing later on in life, and she felt it was the only way she could cure her illness. But there is no evidence to support this speculation. The other speculation to explain why Elizabeth became so cruel was because she was brought up that way, trained by her family, if you like. She was subjected, right from an early age, to witness the cruelty of her family, especially that of her father. She would see firsthand the brutal punishment that he dished out through the family offices, and also because she was taught by family members who were involved in Satanism and witchcraft. But again, there is no evidence to support this. Raised as a Calvinist Protestant, Elizabeth learnt Latin, German, Hungarian, and Greek. She was endowed with wealth, education, and a prominent social rank because of the family she was born into. Now, it is alleged that when she was 13 years of age, she gave birth to a child, fathered by a peasant boy. However, the child was taken from Elizabeth and given to a local woman who the family trusted. But this was never heard of during Elizabeth's life, and the evidence to suggest the event only came up after she had died. Like many children in this era, Elizabeth was engaged to marry at the age of 10. She then married a man called Fernach Nasidi, and it is believed that the arrangement was solely political. Elizabeth, being of a significantly higher social standing, refused to change her last name, and subsequently Nasidi took hers and became a Báthory. For their wedding, Elizabeth was gifted her husband's household, Castle of Chida, as well as Chida Country House and several villages. In 1578, Elizabeth's husband went away as chief commander, leading the Hungarian troops in the war against the Ottomans. So Elizabeth took on the responsibility of managing the estates and the business affairs. And then, during the Long War, 1593 to 1606, Elizabeth was charged with the defence of those estates, which laid en route to Vienna. There was a significant threat, and previously, the village of Chiget had been ransacked by the Ottomans. There were even several instances where Elizabeth intervened on behalf of destitute women whose husbands had been captured, and even a woman who had been raped and impregnated. Elizabeth had a daughter, Anna, and she was born in 1585, as well as other children, including Ursula, Catlin, Andres, and Pal. It is even believed that Elizabeth could have had other children, but there is limited or contradicting evidence in the chronicles to support this theory. The couple had been married for 29 years before Fernach passed away at the age of 48, and it was the person he entrusted the care of his heirs and widow to that actually eventually led the investigation into Elizabeth and her crimes. The question now is, what did Elizabeth Báthory actually do? Well, rumours had been filling the kingdom, and this led to a Lutheran minister to complain about her both publicly and in the court at Vienna. But initially the authorities in Hungary took some time to respond, but then in 1610, King Matthias II ordered Thurzo, the Palatine of Hungary, to investigate the concerns. Evidence was collected in the March of 1610, and by October they had 52 witness statements. But then by 1611, the number had dramatically risen to over 300. Now, according to the testimonies, Elizabeth's first victims were girls aged between 10 and 14 years of age. It is said that she began killing the daughters of the lower class that were sent to gynaecium to learn courtly etiquette, and then she began abducting girls as well. Elizabeth was described as having carried out evil atrocities, such as severe beatings, as well as the burning or mutilation of the girls' hands. She would bite the flesh off of their faces, arms, and other body parts, and then allowed them to freeze and starve to death. The use of needles was also mentioned in the court. It is also recorded that Elizabeth would burn the girls with hot tongs and then place them in the freezing cold water, as well as having them covered in honey and then live ants. She was also suspected to have committed cannibalism. Now, witnesses named relatives who went missing from gynaecium, and others reported to have seen traces of torture on the bodies of the dead girls, some who were then buried in unmarked locations or graveyards. Two court officials even claimed to have witnessed Elizabeth torture and kill young servant girls. Now, the courts knew of the heinous acts carried out by Elizabeth, and it was then agreed that she should be arrested. Elizabeth was arrested, along with four of her servants, Elizabeth for her crimes and her servants for being accomplices. Her servants were then tortured before being burnt at the stake. Thurzo, the official who had actually arrested Elizabeth, wrote the following to his wife after the arrest. He claimed that during his unannounced visit, he found one dead girl and another living prey girl in the castle. Although it is commonly believed that Elizabeth was caught in the act of torture, she was actually having dinner. Thurzo made an announcement to Elizabeth's guests and the villagers that she was caught red-handed, where actually she was arrested before the discovery or presentation of the victims. It seems that the claims of Thurzo finding Elizabeth covered in blood was actually the embellishment of fictionalized accounts. When it comes to the punishments that Elizabeth received for her crimes, initially it seems that she got away scot-free, so to speak. It was planned by Thurzo and two of Elizabeth's sons that she would be sent to a nunnery. This is because a trial and execution would cause a large amount of unwanted attention to such an influential family, and they would be disgraced, and there would have also been a scandal. But as the news spread like a wildfire through the lesser nobility, it was agreed that she would be kept under strict house arrest and further punishments should be avoided. Now, most of the witnesses stated that although they had heard the accusations from others, they did not in fact see it themselves. And Elizabeth's servants confessed under torture, making their confessions non-credible. So, the accusations of murder was essentially based on rumours, and there is no evidence that anyone who lived in the area that Elizabeth did actually complained about the Countess. It is important to remember that if someone were harmed, or if someone stole something like a farm animal such as a chicken, then a letter of complaint would have been written. But there wasn't. But, nevertheless, two trials were held in the wake of her arrest. The first was the 2nd of January 1611, and the second was the 7th of January. Elizabeth faced no further punishment other than being under what we would call today house arrest for the rest of her life in the castle she called home. Contradicting reports state that she could move freely and unhindered in the castle, but another, a letter written by Thurzo, states that she was kept in a bricked-up room. Elizabeth lived until she was 54 years of age, where she died in her sleep. It is reported that she complained to her bodyguard that her hands were cold, to which he replied, "It's nothing, miss, just go lie down." So she did, and in the morning she was found dead. Elizabeth was then buried in the church of Chater, buried in the church at Chater Castle, but due to the uproar of the villagers, she was then moved to her birth home at Edgehead, where her body was interred at the Báthory family crypt. Throughout time, historians have believed that Elizabeth could have potentially just been a victim of conspiracy, and that the proceedings against her were largely politically motivated because of her extensive wealth and her ownership of large areas of Hungarian land. But another argument is that the investigation into her crimes was sparked by the complaints made against her. Did Thurzo exaggerate to greatly benefit his own political state ambitions? We will never know if the stories are true, or if Elizabeth was actually the victim. But nevertheless, victim or not, the tale of Elizabeth Báthory turned into folklore and inspired many stories during the 18th and 19th century. These folklore depict Elizabeth bathing in the blood of her victims to retain her beauty and youth. This legend then appeared in print for the first time in 1729 in the Jesuit scholar Laszlo Taroszkia Tragica Historia. And this is also the first written account of Elizabeth's case. The witness accounts from her trial were published for the first time in 1817, and this is where the story came into question, because the witness statements include zero references to bloodbaths. It is difficult to really know how factually the accounts of Elizabeth Báthory's case are, as word of mouth can get twisted as it is passed from person to person to person. But that being said, if Elizabeth Báthory did really commit the crimes put against her, sadistic pleasure is the most plausible motive for her sins. Thank you for watching, and to support, please subscribe to Her Remarkable History. Thank you.